Welcome to EPG Pathshala. This is Dr. Mrinmoy Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today, we will discuss a module on Canadian short stories of the Indigenous writers. This module is written by Dr. Devashri Dattarai, Assistant Professor, Jadavpur University. Content of the module is like a native heritage, images of the Indian in English-Canadian literature, 1981, is one of the first book-length studies to examine the image of the native in literature. Discussing text by English-Canadian writers, Leslie Monkman showed how native peoples were characterized as savage and primitive, so as to treat the Indian as a doomed figure of the past, through which to assert a lost heroic vitality and cultural elegy of the new world, portraying the Indian as the antithesis of the white culture. These writers practiced the colonial fantasy of native extinction by relegating the Indian to a literary critical terrain generated through the displacement, erosion, and death of indigenous cultures. Non-native writers, under various paradigmatic shift in history, have deployed the Indian and his culture either as a stereotype against which to assert the values of his own culture, or as a site of culture and history appropriated to concerns common to all cultures. According to Monkman, Canada had neither come to terms with the cultures of its native peoples nor avoided exploiting the culture of a vanquished people. It is evident that there is a link between domination and representation. Domination by colonial powers led to misrepresentation of indigenous peoples in art, culture, literature, politics, sociology. They have been viewed as artifacts, museum pieces to be dissected, diagnosed, and interpreted. Like fictional characters such as Man Friday, Caliban, or Queequeg, they have been taught, tamed, and civilized as part of the white man's burden. A Eurocentric perspective is forced upon cultural products located in different specificities. Again, a sensitivity to difference, the primary tool of investigation per se, dissipates in the face of Elizabeth Spelman's boomerang perception. I look at you and come right back to myself. What concerns one more is not merely to identify with Aboriginal Canadian literatures in the contextualized trinity of race, moment, and milieu, which relates literary creations to the external dispositions of national character, pressures of the natural environment, and periods of cultural development. In the context of Aboriginal Canadian writings, Taine's classical three-pronged approach to study forms of art could be reworked and therefore subverted if one asked which race, which moment, whose milieu. Because this would show how the history of nation, the making of natural environment, and the influence of culture narrate a painful story of colonization for the founding peoples of the Americas in the post-contact period. Post-contact or post-colonialism is in itself a debatable term in the indigenous vocabulary, as is best articulated by Aboriginal activist Bobby Skye, Bobby Sykes, who asked at an academic conference on postcolonialism, what postcolonialism? Have they lived? Moreover, in the Canadian context, the notion of Canada itself is ambiguous. Sophie McCall explains, the Canada-US border has long been considered a soft border, more a state of mind than a physical presence. However, for Aboriginal peoples, the border is a constant reminder of colonial history. It is an enduring scar that not only obscures the violent appropriation of Aboriginal territories over the past 400 years, but also effaces old maps of native North American nations. Therefore, a reading into Indigenous literatures becomes even more pertinent with the political significance of the 49th parallel. The 49th parallel is more than often ignored by Aboriginal authors in North America as a superfluous identity imposed by imperial administration. Within the Aboriginal Canadian context, it is not merely reflective of periods of transition, but also has become an effective tool which incorporates the oral in the written form, a socio-political and principally Aboriginal perspective. Critics adhering to Eurocentric ideological credo vis-a-vis the novel have found the treatment of genre by Indigenous writers to be problematic. Perhaps a crucial difference between Aboriginal communities and non-Aboriginal communities is the significance of the individual with community. Aboriginal literature is pivoted on this particular relationship. Beth Brandt writes, "We do not write as individuals communing with a muse. We write as members of our ancient cultural conscience. Our muse is us." There is therefore a relationship between all that is part of the living. This would include nature, land, people, and customs. For the Aboriginal, a holistic approach which would accommodate subjectivity, creativity, culture, language, and environmental ethics and the ecosystem is an essential ingredient towards a respectful understanding of Aboriginal literatures. In this manner, interpretation of text in Eurocentric ways is problematized and negative attitudes towards native cultures are highlighted. Negative attitudes towards native Canadian functions on the assumption that it is the latter who requisite learning the ways of the world, who must acclimatize and assimilate themselves in the world of knowledge, science, and reason. Missionaries, explorers, and colonialists have perpetuated the myth of the untamed Indian. Thomas King, in his introduction to the Native in Literature, speaks of three visions of the Indian as the dissipated savage, the barbarous savage, and the heroic savage. Marguerite Fee, in her essay entitled Romantic Nationalism and the Image of Native People in Contemporary English-Canadian Literature, examines how romantic nationalism has also shaped the image of the native and how the limited but telling roles that native characters have been allowed to assume reflect the need of non-natives for a character who can represent all that the modern person has lost. Helen Hoy, in her discussion on appropriation of native culture and stereotypical projection of native Canadians, adds, "The urgent white Canadian self-image of non-racist tolerance, often cited in contradistinction to US American inequity, with First Nations as the critical Canadian test case. To face theory of romanticism, one needs therefore to recognize what Wayne de Loera Jr. means when he says, people can tell just by looking at us what we want, what should be done to help us, how we feel, and what a real Indian is really like. Indian life, as it relates to the real world, is a continuous attempt not to disappoint people who know us. The identity of the native thus has undergone shifts pertaining not always to the socio-political realities of the indigenous, but rather to legal, constitutional definitions of the Indian as present within a colonial and racist framework in the Canadian democracy. Kateri Dam observes, there are status Indians, non-status Indians, Métis, Inuit, Dén, Treaty Indians, Urban Indians, On-Reserve Indians, Off-Reserve Indians. There are Indians who are band members and Indians who are not band members. There are First Nations peoples, descendants of First Nations, Natives, Indigenous peoples, Aboriginal peoples, mixed bloods, mixed breeds, half-breeds, enfranchised Indians, Bill C-31 Indians. There are even women without any First Nations ancestry who gained Indian status by marriage. And these are just some of the levels we must consider in identifying ourselves. There are also definitions based on tribal First Nations affiliation, on language, on blood, quantum. But what does this have to do with a discussion of literature? The socio-political definitions labeled upon an Aboriginal person in Canada are related to a prolonged history of colonial oppression. The innumerous categories assigned by the Canadian government to its Aboriginal populations epitomize the Western imperial mind's desire to fit the unknown into a ready-made compartment. In the realm of literature, scholars who have received training in European critical traditions work in tandem with different aesthetic assumptions and the narrative structures. The tendency is to impose favorite literary theories on the indigenous text without any prior knowledge of indigenous literature. Therefore, an Aboriginal writer in her works uses the medium of the written word to initiate the process of decolonization. Such a status quo forces one to discuss positionality of author in relation to the text, a location predicated upon colonial definitions and impositions. This is true of contemporary writers who also are plagued by the Western concept of individual voice in creativity. Duane Niyatam explains, songs in the old days were not called art. Art objects such as poems, paintings, sculptures, pots and rugs were considered expressions of the community as a whole, not as personal. However, to expect such selfless portrayal of the work of art without naming its creator can lead to other problems. The appropriation of the indigenous story has been an abiding issue. The indigenous writers have been indignant on being silenced, and when plastic shamans have usurped their positions, such as the legendary Grey Owl, appropriation of knowledges and resources is a historical reality for indigenous peoples across the world. An understanding of the process of appropriation encapsulates the idea of decolonization. As Linda Tuhiwai Smith analyzes, it gulls us that Western researchers and intellectuals can assume to know all that is possible to know of us. On the basis of their brief encounters with some of us, it appals us that the West can desire, extract, and claim ownership of our ways of knowing, our imagery, the things we create and produce, and then simultaneously reject the people who created and developed those ideas and seek to deny them further opportunities to be creators of their own culture and own nation. The process charts out the map of appropriation. In the early contact with Western explorers, appropriation was in the form of natural resources. Indigenous people's early experiences with Western cultures were ones of exploitation, where the natural resources were appropriated to fuel the economic growth of the Western world. The appropriation was of physical resources, metals, gems, herbs, spices, animals, and land for agriculture and settlement. That which had economic value was plundered to the extent that few communities were able to enjoy the quality of life they had experienced before Western contact. Occurring simultaneously with this process has been the appropriation of wisdom and knowledges in the uses of medicinal herbs, hunting animals, and obtaining of local knowledge of edible plants and animals to allow survival in environments alien to Western understanding. In the contemporary context, Indigenous writers have asked non-native writers to not borrow their stories. According to them, the process of appropriation deprived Indigenous people culturally and economically. Since the stories were either misinterpreted or the profits from the same were not made available to Aboriginal communities, in 1988, Lee Miracle asked Anne Cameron, author of best-selling novel Daughters of Copper Woman, 1981, to stop using traditional native stories in her work. In 1989, controversy broke out over the representation of minority Canadian writers at the Payne Conference in Toronto. In 1990, the Canada Council set up an advisory committee for racial equality in the arts. Perhaps needless to say, its report was controversial. Finally, a conference called Writing Through Race, which excluded those who are not members of an ethnic minority from most of its workshops, was held in Vancouver in 1995. Hartmut Luge's collection of 18 conversations with Native Canadian authors in contemporary challenges has also dealt with this issue at length with a large group of Indigenous writers. Responding to the 1988 Telling It conference to a question about learning without appropriating, Armstrong points out that we do as native writers suffer because of the kind of cultural imperialism that is taking place when non-natives speak about native ceremony and native thinking, native thought, native lifestyle, native worldview, and speak as though they know what they are speaking about. That is appropriation of culture, because no one can experience and know what I know and experience, or what my grandmother knows, or what Lee Miracle knows and feels, and she can speak with her own voice, and so can I, and so can my grandmother. Neither can post-colonialism be an answer to the reading of Indigenous text. There is also, amongst Indigenous academics, the sneaky suspicion that the fashion of post-colonialism has become a strategy for re-inscribing or re-authorizing the privileges of non-Indigenous academics, because the field of post-colonial discourse has been defined in ways which can still live out Indigenous peoples, their ways of knowing, and their current concerns. For any attempts towards understanding Indigenous literatures, it is important to be sensitive to the history of colonization of Native peoples from a Native perspective. In order to do justice to a reading in Native literature, one must have culturally specific knowledge of treaties and assimilation policies, such as forcefully removing children from foster homes and residential schools, a perspective familiarity with the Indian Act and its racist imperial categories and legislations, and an awareness of epoch-making events symbolizing the extant colonial regime as well as modes of indigenous resistance to the same in native history, such as Alcatraz, Wounded Knee, Oka, or the confrontation at Iparwash and the death of Dudley George. A turning point in Native Canadian criticism occurred during the late 1980s and early 1990s through a series of high-profile public events involving Native writers that challenged the ideological containment of Native literature through its positioning within a generalized cross-cultural comparative framework. The establishment of A.N. Working School of Intonation First Nation writing in the Okanagan Valley, Penticton, BC on September 12, 1989 marked the determination of Native authors to carry on traditions of storytelling in the contemporary period and simultaneously using all modern technologies and equipment. The agency of storytelling is a metaphor for a gesture which is simultaneously cultural, social, and political. It asserts and affirms identity, resists artificially constructed binaries, and transmits and sustains alternative historical truths. This gesture toward the establishment of a counter-tradition within which to locate Aboriginal writing has also fostered a historicization of the field that privileges the literature's engagement with social and political context. Mohawk writer Beth Bratt had suggested that our spirit, our sweat, our tears, our laughter, our love, our anger, our bodies are distilled into words that we bead together to make power. For both Maracle and Brandt, the contemporary act of storytelling is a complicated one. It has a twofold function, primarily through its immediate role of narration within a written format. It gives a sense of being told to, as in verbal storytelling. Secondly, it also gains significance as a written art preserved for posterity. At all junctions, storytelling involves a complex process of expressing the significance of language through a narration of the event or plot, and also draws attention to multiple narrative strands across translucent borders of cultural paradigms. Among the most prolific Aboriginal writers in Canada today, Maracle has published more than 10 works in all, including novels, poetry, short story collection, and collaborative anthologies. In 2000, Maracle received the J.T. Stewart Voices of Change Award. A collaborative work, First Fish, First People, earned an American Book Award from the Before Columbus Foundation. A graduate in sociology and creative writing from Simon Fraser University, Maracle has held numerous distinguished academic posts, including the Stanley Knowles Visiting Professor in Canadian Studies at the University of Waterloo, the Distinguished Professor of Canadian Culture at Western Washington University, and Writer in Residence at the University of Guelph. She is currently Associate Professor in the Department of English at the University of Toronto. Writer in Residence for the University's Aboriginal Studies program, the traditional cultural director for the Indigenous Theatre School. The significance of these achievements is manifold, given the fact for Maracle and as for her other Aboriginal writers, English has been a foreign tongue forcibly imposed upon them, and to express the vivid orality inherent in Indigenous languages is an arduous and daunting task. Matters are even more complicated when Indigenous people encounter parents who are unable to teach them values imbibed in their languages, since they too have been crippled by the colonizer's tongue. In Miracle's short story, Charlie, the protagonist, loses interest in the didactic system of Western schooling because it involves learning without thinking or true understanding. At least from an Indigenous point of view, for example, in Miracle's short story, Bartha, the drunken old factory woman, is unable to offer solace to her drunken co-factory worker, a girl from younger generation. Bartha feels miserable as she is able to comfort or offer stories of sustenance to the young girl, who in her turn is scared by the alien words which emanate from Bartha's tongue. Miracle points out, the difficulty for me has been mastering a language different from my own without having my own. Most of us learned English from parents who spoke English in translation. Many of our parents had been to residential schooling and thus did not speak the old language any better than the average 5-year-old speaks English. Miracle is well read in the history of her own people. According to her, Canada is still a disconnected condition of diaspora and chronic invasion. While Canada no longer touts herself as a peaceful and neutral nation, she has also been allying herself to and participating in the United States aggression. With the publication of I Am Woman in 1988, Miracle developed a social treatise on feminism from an Indigenous perspective and also offered a theory for Indigenous literature arising from orature. Miracle was brought up in the context of a clan system in which the central means of acquiring knowledge was story. The business of story creation was a collective endeavor. Through it, discipline was learned or not. Instructions were never given. They were shown various ways of seeing things, doing things and consequences, and the discovery of impact of their personal behavior was always the desired outcome. This has been one of the major influences in her life. As a gifted speaker and storyteller, she has received attention from orators in her community. Some of the first speakers, storyers, and thinkers among the Salish people. Cherokee author Thomas King has also been a significant writer from Indigenous Canada and has often challenged stereotypical definitions on the native Canadian. In fact, in the short story Borders, King highlights the redundancy of post-contact political borders for Aboriginal communities. Thomas King has also explained that his apathy towards the term post-colonial as a label for the native literature arises from the Euro-American tendency to assume that the evil of colonialism has been overcome through a convenient process of evolution. Moreover, the term suggests that Aboriginal history is pivoted upon a singular event, the coming of the European colonist in North America. King states his preference for describing native literature in terms of the tribal, the interfusional, the polemical, and the associational. Tribal is the term for literature of one tribal community in its own native language. The interfusional is the blending of oral and written literature. The polemical highlights the clash of native and non-native cultures, and the associational is concerned with neither plot nor individual exploits, but rather referred to Thomas King's satirical short story entitled A Short History of Indians in Canada. The title of the story alludes to colonialist gestures within European historiography, which has often relegated the history of Indians to a footnote or at most a derogatory paragraph. Located in Toronto, the story describes how two city employees, specifically sweepers, clean the streets of the city of any flying, dropping Indians. They are only seen as a tourist attraction, and sometimes it is a pity that people traveled through Toronto and did not even see an Ojibwe. For Mohawk writer Beth Brandt, telling the truth of ourselves, a novel idea to be sure and one that is essential to the nurturance of new voices in our communities. The urgency of such truth-telling is related to the intimate relationship shared by contemporary ethnocide and genocide to socio-political struggles and apprehensions about the nature of colonial impulses. In her short stories, Brandt foregrounds her Mohawk identity. In her collection of short stories entitled Food and Spirits, Brandt begins her native narrative with This Is History, a rendition of Mohawk creation story. The story includes the archetypal images of indigenous creation stories, such as earth being formed from a turtle's back through a collaboration of eagle, turtle, and muskrat. Further, it also stresses upon the role of nature within creation and the healing power of women within indigenous communities. Brandt insists that story is in fact history and crucial for an understanding of indigenous philosophy and way of life. Swimming Upstream is motivational short story by Brandt, which focuses on the relation between ability to partake lessons from nature for life. The protagonist regains her will to live after watching Salman swim upstream. Therefore, the story is a tale of resistance and fortitude. Emma Lee Warrior, Blackfoot, writes, "Yet though the sounds I hear back home are more English than Blackfoot, I find the stories told more from a Blackfoot language perspective, be they legend, custom, or accounts of everyday happenings. They have a rich combination of awe for the power of our natural surroundings, a laughing at absurdity and the pain of oppression. I have been advised to look to the future. But my head keeps turning around to the wisdom back there, away from 7-Elevens and 24-hour video stores." The ability to creatively transform and transcribe these words into their writings has often been an abiding goal for indigenous writers. Yet the demarcation between the two worlds might prove to be a painful one. Moreover, the two worlds are often in a lopsided transaction, whereby the more powerful white culture would rather subsume the indigenous one and not choose to listen. According to Paula Gunn Allen, Native society allows for many different personal styles. The organization of individuals into wide-ranging fields of allowable styles, she says, creates the greatest possible social stability because it includes and encourages variety of personal expression for the good of the group. This reflects the Indian concept of a circular, dynamic universe in which all things are related and are of one family. Therefore, in the process, the individual is not an isolated island of perfection or imperfection, but is given value or significance as a person from the community. This means Aboriginal person is almost always rooted to the community and therefore receives sustenance, healing, and power from the same. The strong sense of cultural community emanates from the writings of all of the authors in focus. Indigenous Canadian writers use story empowerment for not only themselves, but also for their own people. The point is to reclaim the significant self, which is only possible by focusing on the feminine within Aboriginal thought and philosophy. For further assessment and learn more, you can consult the respective folders and files. Thank you.